Hello, welcome back to Elise Reads and Speaks. Today I am bringing you my July wrap-up. So if you remember, I decided to make July my Netgalley month and get through as many galleys as I possibly could. I had 10 on my TBR and I got through 7. That doesn't mean that I only read 7 books this month. There was a lot of audiobooks that I read too, but hey, I'm pretty proud of getting through 7 ebooks. Like that, those are some physical books that I did not fall asleep while reading. I think that's pretty good. So what I'm gonna do, the normal thing is that I start at the beginning of the month and go through what I read until the end of the month. And I usually do a little recap, but just so I'm not giving the same synopses to you over and over and over again, because I already went through this for my TBR, I'm gonna link that video down below for me making July Netgalley month. And if you wanna learn more about any of these Netgalleys that I've read, go check out that video for a better synopsis and finding out when the dates are that they come out. Okay? All right, let's just kick it off with the beginning of the month. I started with the audiobook of The Vanishing Deep by Astrid Scholte. I gave this one 3.5 stars and I kind of like rounded it up to 4. This one had such potential. The premise is that like in this world that kind of just, I guess, revolves around water, there's some scientific thing that families can partake in, that if they've lost somebody to drowning, they can get 24 more hours with them. But there's like a caveat, like you can't tell the person that's coming back that they're going to die or somehow prepare them to die again or something like that. I know that it sounds strange, but it's also very interesting. Like the premise is that this girl lost her sister to drowning. So she like saves up this money and whatnot to get 24 more hours with her sister. And then this kind of mystery happens that they find out, like, you know, maybe her death wasn't so innocent as it seems. Maybe somebody was after their family. Why would somebody be after their family? I don't know. So she was trying to like beat the system so that she can get more than 24 hours with her sister that had died. So I will say, this author is so close. She's also the author of 4 Dead Queens, and I really enjoyed that one. That was another 4 star for me, but it was just too much information packed into one book. Like, that should have been spread out over a couple books. With this one, you know, I felt like the information wasn't too much for one book, but it was just lacking that special something. I thought it was so creative, but it was just missing something for me. This author is close. I feel like possibly the next book they have, or maybe the book after that, is gonna be a 5-star for me. So I feel like she's becoming an auto-buy author for me, just because the stuff she comes up with is so creative, and she's almost there, but not quite. Next, I went on to All the Bad Apples by Moira Fowley-Doyle. This one was kind of weird. So I am finding that I am just trying magical realism again and again and again, and it just doesn't work for me. I don't know why, because like I really love fantasy, I love magical elements and stuff, but I feel like when you're giving me a real story and then you just throw in some magic, it's kind of like, I don't know, it's a little jarring and I don't like it. I either want you to go like 100% or I want you to just take it out. I don't like this little like 20% stuff. I don't know, it just doesn't make sense to me. So I enjoy the reality part of this story. It dealt with such like heavy themes like kind of like sexual abuse, domestic abuse, abandonment, not even adoption, but like somebody has a baby and then passes it off as her sister and her mom passed it off as her own kid. Like there was a lot of things going on in here, and the deeper themes, I feel like it would really speak to somebody else that enjoyed magical realism, because I just didn't. It was like banshees? I don't even know what a banshee is, and they didn't even describe it that well, but all of a sudden there were banshees at the end. Like, what? The thing I like the most is the author's note at the end. This author is Irish, and she was kind of saying that she wrote the story because of what happens to women in Ireland when they get pregnant and decide to get an abortion. Most times they have to go over country lines because it's forbidden to have abortion in Ireland. I don't know if that's still current or if it was when she wrote the story, or maybe it had just ended when she wrote that author's note. I forget, okay? But she wrote that story for like all women in Ireland, and when I read the author's note after reading the book, I was like, okay, like I understand what she was trying to do, and I saw that she had a message that she wanted to share with everyone, and I appreciated that, and I got that, and it kind of like bumped it up a little bit for me. But the story itself, it was still like, it was like a 2.5 that I rounded up to 3 stars. Then I went on to The Heir Affair by Heather Cox and Jessica Morgan, and this is the sequel to The Royal We. I loved this. Okay, I loved The Royal We, and I got in touch with the publisher, and I was like, this one is coming out this year. If you could just send me an ARC, that would be great. But as it got closer to publication date, they just sent me a free finished copy in the mail, which is, oh, I'm so happy. So this one I really enjoyed, but I will say it's going to separate the fans of The Royal We, because there's a big curveball that happens in this one that you're either going to be on board with, like I was, or I completely understand the people that are not going to be on board with it, and they're going to be like, whoa, what were you thinking? That being said, I enjoyed it, and I gave it 4 stars. Then I went on to The Southern Book Club's Guide to Slaying Vampires by Grady Hendrix. That was weird, guys. That was weird. You know, it started off really strong. Like, I loved the beginning of the book. I loved it. I was picturing these, like, old women from The Help. Not even old women, but like, you know, the Southern girls in The Help and how just catty and whatnot they were. That's what I was kind of imagining, except they were just like a little bit older in my mind than they were in The Help, talking about true crime. They decided to read these books and like they got really into reading books about murder and stuff. And it was so fun. And I was like, okay, like they're setting the groundwork here. And I thought it was gonna go this way, that they all kind of got together and got too excited and figured there was a vampire in their midst or something like that and went out to kill him or something. But it took like a really weird turn, really weird, and it dragged on. It dragged on and on, and by the end of the book, I was like, please just finish already. So I ended up giving it 3 stars. I mean, honestly, when I think of the end of the book, it doesn't even deserve 3 stars, but I loved the beginning so much. Like, it had such great potential, and the beginning I just tore through, you know, it was so good. So I feel like it at least deserves the 3 stars for the beginning of the book, but the middle to the end, like, what the hell, man? What the hell? Okay, now here's where I started in the month reading the Netgalley ARCs that I got. So I started off with Nameless Queen by Rebecca McLoughlin, and I loved it. I gave it 4 stars. This was the one that she lived in the Nameless Caste, so she didn't really have a name. And when the king or queen dies, before they die, they're supposed to name somebody that's gonna get this tattoo transferred from them onto their body somewhere. So when the king dies, all of a sudden this tattoo pops up on this girl. However, she's from the Nameless Caste, so how did she get named? It was just, it was exciting. And I got through the end and I really liked it. And I feel like it's set up for another book to come that way. I feel like it could go on a little further if they chose to. So, that was good. That was a good start to my Netgalley ARCs. The next one that I went on to was not an ARC. It was an audiobook that I listened to that was My Calamity Jane, which is part of, I think it's called the Lady Janie series. It's a series, but you don't need to read them in order. They're all separate stories. It's by Cynthia Hand, Jodi Meadows, and Brodi Ashton. Now, this Jane was based on Calamity Jane, Annie Get Your Gun, that era of Western type stuff. And they always pick like a fantastical element to put in there. So with My Lady Jane, they had, you know, the husband turning into a horse. In My Plain Jane, they had ghosts that Jane Eyre was dealing with. In My Calamity Jane, there was werewolves, and it was exciting. Western stuff really isn't my jam. I'm just not into like the guns and the lassos and cowboy stuff. It's just not for me. But the story itself, like, I jived with. I was interested in. It was enough to give it 3 stars, but so far, nothing is comparing to My Lady Jane. To me, that's my favorite of the three so far. Then I went on to another ARC that was The Monster Inside by Eva Casey Velasquez, and that was really interesting. It was the girl's story of her background with sexual abuse and how she goes through life and ends up being the CEO of this charitable organization that gives back to people that were in the same situation that she was in. And I mean, it was all right. I gave it 3 stars. It was just, you know, it was somebody's life that I was just reading about. It wasn't anything particularly gripping for me. I felt like it must have been cathartic for her to write, and I hope that it was, but it it's not one that I would highly recommend to other people, and not one that I have been thinking about afterwards. So 3 stars for that one. Then I read Invisible Differences by Julie Dachez, which was the graphic novel dealing with autism, and I loved it. I gave it 5 stars. I loved it. I'm not even heavy into graphic novels, and I just, oh my gosh, it was so good. I actually want to read it again, and I probably will, because it really doesn't take that long to read because it's a graphic novel. So good. It was so good. Like, the graphic novel starts out with black and white with splashes of red, and then by the end of the graphic novel, as she's discovering like what autism means and how she can deal with the world while understanding autism now, and there's all the colors that get added in just besides, you know, black, white, and red. Oh, it was so good. It was so good, and I felt like it was just required reading for people that need to learn more about autism. Oh, it was just, oh, it was wonderful. It was absolutely wonderful. 5 stars. The next arc up was The Royal Abduls by Ramiza, Shamoun, Koya, and this one was just okay for me. I ended up giving it 3 stars. I liked the main character, and I felt like she was kind of independent woman and making a lot of decisions for herself, which I enjoyed. I was fully prepared to give this one 0 stars if she folded to her family, because I was like, I did not get this far in this story for that kind of ending. But it was just middle of the road for me. There were some things that I liked in it. This was the book that dealt with the post 9/11 sentiment, and it's a Muslim American family dealing with stuff from that, but it wasn't just that too. There was a lot of family stuff that was going on, and I felt like it was just putting too much into one book. Like, you're dealing with, you know, she just is going against her religion, you know, or at least coming to terms with her religion, maybe not going against it, but then her family's expecting so much of her. There was a divorce in there, there's some death in there, and like more than one death. There's the nephew of hers that's dealing with wanting to be more in touch with his cultural background and struggling, and his parents aren't there for him, and she's kind of like an interim parent. It was just, it was a lot. It was a lot for one book, and I think if the author had narrowed the focus even just a little bit, I would have enjoyed it more, but nah. Middle of the road, 3 stars. Then I went on to Entwined by A.J. Rosen, and I loved this one. I love this one. I mean, I was highly anticipating this one. This one had like Greek mythology, and I knew there was going to be a love triangle of some sort. I mean, both of those things together, wonderful. Okay, so I will say that it's not like the best thing I've ever read. The writing was a little younger, but the story itself is fabulous. It's fabulous. Like, and it's set up for more to come, and I will definitely read the next ones. And then the Entwined part, if you remember from my previous video, this was like she goes to what's called a gathering to see if she feels that click with somebody, and once you feel that click, that means that you've met your soulmate and your mind can entwine with them, and you read each other's thoughts and stuff, okay? It's about finding your soulmate. So that doesn't even turn out to be like the main part of the story. The main part is this like mystery that's happening, and this these assassins really that are coming out of the woodwork to try and destroy some of the top tier families that are descended from the Greek gods and stuff. Like, that part was so much more interesting. Granted, I love the soulmate stuff, don't get me wrong. That's like my jam. I love it. Okay, but there was some other stuff in the story that was really, really good. I think if the writing was just a little better than what it was, it could have been a 5-star for me for sheer enjoyment, but I'm sticking with 4-star for that one, but I will definitely read the next one. Then I went on to The Year Shakespeare Ruined My Life by Dani Jansen. I had such high hopes for this one because I am a theater kid. I love A Midsummer Night's Dream. I did theater in high school, and this is like all of the things combined that I loved, and I did not love this book. It was just, ugh. It wasn't even like angsty. Like, any climactic situation that would happen, you know, any struggle, any conflict was just kind of resolved immediately, and it didn't seem to mean anything. And it, I felt like I would get built up a little bit and then pfft, and then built up a little bit and pfft. Like, it didn't even get built up to here. It was just like a little like bump in the road, bumps. Which, I mean, I guess is kind of high school, but I don't know. I think of my conflicts in high school and they felt like the end of the world, you know? Like, I expected something to feel like that, but it just, it wasn't like that. And putting a high schooler as a producer of a play, I mean, who does that? Who does that? Nobody does that because it's a stupid decision. That's why. Like, oh, I don't know. It just wasn't for me. The one thing that I liked in here was that everyone was very open about talking about their sexuality, and when people finally came out with their different sexualities that they had, the people in this theater group were really accepting and open, and just they just took everybody as they were, which I think needs to be normalized in young adult books. I think there are a lot of young adults out there that need to read something like that and see that, hey, it's okay to say who you are out loud because there will be a group of people that supports you. So I like what the book was trying to do there, so at least earned 2 stars for me. But the rest of the story, nah, man, I was just bored and very, very disappointed, so 2 stars. Then I listened to the audiobook of And I Darken by Kiersten White. Now, this is like a backlist title that apparently everyone's read except me. And I was just kind of middle of the road on it. I gave it 3 stars. I really don't have a lot to say. I don't know. I mean, I do like seeing, you know, LGBT rep in fantasy because you don't often get that, especially for gay guys. I don't know why that is. Why is there not like a lot of gay men in the fantasy I read? I don't know. Okay, but so I did like that in there, but the story itself, I felt like I was just kind of waiting for it to be over. So I won't go on to the next one. The next arc that I got to was The Mirror, Broken Wish by Julie C. Dow. Oh, I love this one. This is 5 stars. Oh man, I have been searching for fairy tale vibes for a while. Like, I love fairy tales. I love fairy tale retellings. Anything to do with fairy tales, I always have to pick it up. All right, this one has just given me what I have been looking for. It's a middle grade book, okay? So like, don't read this and expect, you know, YA or adult type writing and type situations. This is middle grade, but like, it does the fairy tale well. This fairy tale is the one with the couple that can't have a baby, and so they go to the witch next door and make a bargain with her to have the baby. All right, it's that fairy tale. And you know, if you think of that fairy tale, did any of them have names? No, I think it was like, you know, husband and his wife and witch. This story gives them a backstory. It gives them a history together. You see what happens after the fact, like after this baby is grown up, what happens from that point. You see a betrayal happen to the witch so that you're kind of sympathizing with her and you see her more as a person with feelings, with emotions, instead of just some witch that was trying to get what she wanted. Like, oh, what's so good. This is going to be a 4-book series with 4 different authors. Oh, I'm so looking forward to the next one. So looking forward to it. If you are into fairy tales and you've been searching for that like middle grade type vibe that just pulls a fairy tale together so well, this is it. This is it. 5 stars. And then in a strange turn, I then listened to the audiobook of Too Much and Never Enough by Mary L. Trump. I had to. I tried to like reconcile with myself beforehand and just know that like I'm strongly biased against the main person of this book, okay? Like I think he's a moron. So I tried to like say to myself beforehand, okay, you're already highly biased against this person. Be aware of your bias and just try to listen to the information. And man, like that family seems crazy, crazy. And not like crazy serial killer type way, like crazy, really sociopath, okay? Like, I really don't believe that they see anything wrong with how they act, how they treat other people, how like money is kind of like the pinnacle, you know, in their family. Like, that's what means the most, and anybody that can drive you to the money is the one that's gonna have worth. Anybody that doesn't care about building up the Trump name and getting that money, they don't bring anything to the family. Oh. So again, I was trying to be aware of my bias and know that I was gonna hate Donald Trump regardless. But seeing it from this perspective with somebody that has family insight, because she's part of that family, and also knowing that she is a clinician, she's a therapist, and seeing it with a clinical point of view that she brings to Trump, that was interesting. I liked that she was kind of presenting the facts and then with what she's researched with her profession and knowing what she knows from that and kind of like showing that Donald Trump is a sociopath. It was It was very interesting. It was a short book, very quick read. I think it's only around like 300-ish pages, so it took nothing to listen to the audiobook. I would say if you're gonna listen to it or read it, go in the same way as me. Like, be aware of your biases, all right? If you know that you're not gonna like Trump from the beginning of this, just be aware of that, because there are some things where I just felt like I was listening to her talk and I was like, okay, this is another part where I would need to hear the other side of this story. I really liked the clinical perspective, and I think that will appeal to people regardless of where they fall in the Donald Trump spectrum. All right, so that concludes all of the books that I read in July. I got to 14 books again. Huh, almost. 15 is my PR, so I'm really trying to hit like 16 to see if I can get there. Just, you know, for fun, for funsies. All right, thank you for tuning in to Elise Reads and Speaks. I will catch you next time, guys. Bye.